along the way dies down, I think every parent's going to be worried.
Schools are being scrubbed down. Parents are on alert, all after a man in Texas was found to have the deadly Ebola virus. Tonight, several people are being forced to stay in their homes in Texas over fears that they may have had direct contact with this man, Thomas Duncan. He is the first Ebola patient diagnosed in the U.S. And now U.S. officials want to interview as many as 100 other people who may also be at risk. Our Ellen McNamara has the very latest. Ellen?
And Leah, doctors in Texas say they do not believe that the people who they want to interview have any symptoms, but they want to make sure that everyone who may be at risk is closely being watched, including Thomas Duncan's family members, who are now under strict orders to stay home. Not taking any chances. That's the message from top health experts in Texas, power washing the apartment complex where Thomas Duncan was visiting family. And local schools also scrubbed down with parents on alert.
I'm trying to see what kind of safety precautions they're taking at the school for me to determine whether or not, you know, my child is going to be able to return today.
This is officials now reveal four people, including children Duncan was visiting, have been quarantined, explaining they violated the request not to leave the premises.
There's food being delivered to them right now, groceries being delivered. We're arranging for that apartment to be cleaned.
We're told for the next 21 days they need to be checked for fever and other Ebola symptoms as disease detectives work to track down some 100 people who may have had contact with Duncan.
He's still sick. He's doing very. He's still fighting.
Overnight, Duncan's nephew said the father and former chauffeur from Liberia remains in isolation, in serious condition at this Dallas hospital. Officials know the public remains on edge and vow the system is working.
The bottom line here is that we remain confident that we can contain any spread of Ebola within the United States.
Meanwhile, in Hawaii, a man suspected of having Ebola who was placed in isolation did not end up testing positive for Ebola. Leah.
Ellen, thanks. Well, tonight we're going inside your health. We want to take a look at this frightening disease a little more closely. Our medical expert, Dr. Arkell Giorgio, is here, and Tom Durian is back, and we're going to dig into the virus a little bit. Tom, you went to Regents Hospital today, talked to some folks. We'll talk about that in a minute. First, though, Dr. Giorgio, I think one of the important things to consider as we talk about the Ebola virus, now that it's in the U.S., how concerned should we be here? We don't want people getting just freaked out over all this.
I think my advice would be don't freak out, but pay attention, because what happened in Dallas could happen anywhere. We're a global culture. We're flying from here to there. And what happened in Dallas certainly could happen in a Minneapolis hospital. But what is happening in West Africa is very unlikely to happen in the United States. Right. We have a very different healthcare system, a very different public healthcare system. And while we should be concerned, we shouldn't ever think that what's happening in West Africa is going to happen here.
Right. And Tom, you got an experience today of going to Regents Hospital to the emergency room, and they showed you specifically they have a cart together. So if someone comes in with symptoms, they're ready.
Yeah, you probably heard of a crash cart that they have. Yeah. If somebody goes into cardiac arrest, they have a similar kind of cart used just for this purpose with Ebola written all over it. It has a book on it on how to treat these patients. And they've said basically they want to make sure they're prepared. They do believe that the risk is real here in the cities, especially with the traveling back and forth from West Africa. So they wanted to make sure they were ready. They had everything at one point, and you can see here this is the room that they've got ready to go as well in case they do get a patient. And they have seen people with these symptoms, and they've started to treat it. They've started to put that protocol into place a couple times.
Right. It hasn't happened here, but they're prepared. And one of the things they probably do is they've got the gowns, the masks. Arkell, how is this spread? The hospital staff is, of course, ready with all those tools, but how does this disease spread from person to person? We've talked about bodily fluids before. Can you tell us more specifically?
Sure. Well, there's high risk exposure and there's lower risk exposure. So high risk exposure is having bodily contact with body fluids of someone who is both infected with and symptomatic with Ebola virus. Low risk exposure is when you have some prolonged contact. So what is prolonged contact? It is defined as being face to face with someone about 3 feet away. But casual contact, walking by someone with Ebola, is not considered even a low risk contact.
Okay. All right. Well, let's hope it doesn't show up here in Minnesota. But as we found out today, hopefully our hospitals are prepared if it does. All right, thank you both for coming in and telling us more about this. And you can stay with 5 Eyewitness News as we continue to track the spread of the Ebola virus. You can also read all of our past stories at KSTP.com.